So today I want to talk about AI from a theoretical perspective. I've been on plenty of talks recently about AI from a kind of straightforward informational perspective about what AI is, where did it come from, and so on, and how does it operate. This time I want to try and offer a kind of theoretical perspective on things. At the same time, I want to also mention briefly anyway how AI can produce images. So this is a the talk is entitled "Do Robots Dream of Digital Sheep?" And let me just simply say that those of you who are interested in finding out what AI can do in terms of how you can use it and the techniques and so on, there is a series that Digital Futures is hosting where we have a series of tutorials that have involved some of the best experts in the world who are giving us a kind of overview of how do you use it. And this series is going on right now. And if you're interested in looking at watching it and seeing the recordings, because everything is recorded on our YouTube library, here are the links here. I've given you the top here, the Digital Futures library itself, where the previous sessions have already been uploaded. This is the Digital Futures website, and these are the two Instagram accounts, Digital Futures World Instagram and my own Instagram, where I upload all this material. So if you're interested in that, take a screenshot of this and you can access these things. And everything is free. That the logic of Digital Futures is to try and share our passion for architecture so that everyone, even the most disadvantaged in the world, can access that information. So everything is uploaded there. So anyway, so today though, I want to try and do something that I haven't done for a while, and that is to say, try and frame this within a kind of theoretical perspective and try and look at how we might use AI as a kind of a way, a kind of mirror into understand how humans operate, how architects think, and so on. So the title is "Do Robots Dream of Digital Sheep?" And those of you who have seen the movie Blade Runner, that was released in 1982, a movie that was directed by Ridley Scott, and had a huge impact on architects, some of you will recognize this image here. And that's the starting point, in a sense, for this lecture today. Of course, the movie was based on the Blade Runner was based on the novel by Philip K. Dick, "Do Androids Dream of Electric Sheep?" So I think the theme of dreaming is should be fairly obvious there. I'm based in Los Angeles, and back at the beginning of 2019, this meme appeared. On the top here, what it was like in LA the last day of 2018, and on the right, what it's like in Los Angeles today. Let me put my video on. What it became Los Angeles was like the following day. That's because 2019 was the year in which Blade Runner was set. It was released in 1982, but it was set on the 19th to the 21st of November in 2019. And for those of you who are unfamiliar with the story of Blade Runner, it's essentially about these replicants, as it were, who are kind of bioengineered artificial life forms that are being created to operate in the off-world colonies in outer space. And because they've been used in these fairly inhospitable terrains where there's huge radiation and difference in temperature and so on, they're potentially dangerous, and therefore they're given a four-year lifespan, after which they simply die. And the story is basically a group of these replicants come back down to Earth to try and extend their life. They realize they're about to die, and they want to try and extend it. And here you get this on the right-hand side, Roy Batty, who is the most famous of them, the leader, as it were. He's a Nexus 7 model, the most advanced model, and played by Edgar Hauer, who is who was a Dutch actor born in 1944, who actually Rutger Hauer, who was the same age as a famous Dutch architect, also born in 1944, Rem Koolhaas. And then this is Prissy here. These are two of the central characters, the replicants. And in the movie, of course, Harrison Ford plays Deckard, and Deckard is a kind of bounty hunter, sort of policeman whose task is to retire, which means to kill these replicants because they are dangerous. And their real problem about these replicants is not only they're dangerous, but they look identical to humans. So they have to develop an elaborate test called the Voigt-Kant test to try and detect whether or not they are replicants or not. And then that involves checking the way that the pupils of the eye operate and asking them questions about empathy, which of course they don't have empathy. And famously, of course, in this particular episode, in Blade Runner, this replicant we discover is a replicant on the left-hand side, shoots the person interviewing him, who then is taken to hospital. He doesn't die, but he's put in an iron lung. And this points towards another uncanny kind of parallel that's going on in Blade Runner. And that is to say that although it was set the 19th, 21st of November in 2019, it was almost identical to the date at which we discovered COVID. COVID was discovered in Wuhan in China on the 17th of November 2019. So, and what's interesting about both COVID and replicants is they're very difficult to detect, but potentially deadly. We could also possibly see another parallel going on in terms of how do you detect AI, which is also difficult to see because it's invisible. It's around us the whole time on our phones and things. It's what's filtering out our spam, but we can't see it. It's recognizing our friends on Facebook and so on and so on and so on. We can't see it. And one reminds you of the Turing test, which is a way to try and test whether or not AI is convincing. So, and in the movie, there are certain moments which are very prescient, shall we say. Here we have Roy Batty playing chess against Eldon Tyrell. And in a moment, which is kind of that was foreseeing several years later. So in this was 1982, whereas in 1997, Garry Kasparov was beaten by AI at chess, which was a remarkable moment in terms of the development of AI itself. And here, Eldon Tyrell, who is clearly a genius, is beaten by Roy Batty. And here we have these two figures side by side. And basically, Roy Batty had come to Eldon Tyrell to try and find out whether he could extend his life. And Eldon Tyrell says, no, unfortunately, we tried everything, but we can't do that. What is interesting also, if you take the name Eldon Tyrell and you take away the D, you've got Elon. And that maybe points towards something also of interest. And then there's Rachel. And this is probably a moment where the movie gets it completely wrong. Maybe in 1982, it was common to smoke, but very soon after, smoking went out of fashion. And certainly by 2019, nobody would be smoking. But Rachel is the one with whom Harrison Ford, Deckard, has an affair and then eventually has a baby, which sets the scene for the sequel, Blade Runner 2049. So it's worth maybe contemplating whether or not, whether Blade Runner predicted the future. And to some extent, it did remarkably well. There were obviously changes. We don't have replicants, but we do have other artificial life forms in the form of AI, for sure. We don't have flying cars, but we do have drones. We do have maglev trains. We don't have the Tyrell Corporation, but life today is dominated by big tech companies, Google, Amazon, Microsoft, SpaceX, Tesla, you name it. It's dominated by these kind of these worlds. Secondly, we also have the Tesla car. They've now produced the Cybertruck, which was kind of modeled very closely on the Sid Mead's design for these cars that are in Blade Runner itself, and also in Blade Runner 2049. So it's kind of clear that there are certain things that we see today. It wasn't so far wrong. And what was interesting about Tesla's Cybertruck, it was launched on the 19th of November 2019. In other words, on the day on which the movie was set, as a deliberate, shall we say, a deliberate sort of marketing ploy. I want to talk though about this particular character, Refik Anadol. He's not an architect, he's a media artist. He was born in Turkey. And when he was a young boy, he was given a video cassette, because that was the days of video cassettes, of Blade Runner. As a 12-year-old boy in Istanbul, he became fascinated by the world that it was depicting. And in 2012, he moved to LA. He came to LA to go and study at UCLA in the media art department. He wanted to see the city, of Blade Runner. And the first thing he did when he landed in LAX is he got into a taxi and went to downtown LA to go and see this building, the building by his hero, Frank Gehry. And he wanted to see it in the flesh. He's not, in say, an architect, he's a media artist, but he uses buildings both as the data that he feeds into his algorithm, but also as the mechanism for the canvas, as it were, on which he projects his thing. But when he got to see this building in the middle of the night, and at 2 o'clock in the morning, he didn't see this. What he saw was this, a building that effectively was asleep. And he vowed at that moment to try and bring the building alive in some fashion. And this happened in 2018 when he had the opportunity. He was commissioned by the LA Philharmonic to produce an installation whereby he was drawing upon deep learning with the assistance of Google AMI, the Google Artists and Machine Intelligence Group, which is an advisory group that helps artists who are working using deep learning and neural networks. And he produced this event, which is to mark the 100th anniversary of the LA Philharmonic. And it was effectively a projection onto Frank Gehry's Walt Disney Concert Hall of various images that he was using. And it was symbolically, in some senses, the moment, I would say, when AI met architecture. Let me just play you a brief moment, thing. I'll switch the sound off for the moment to just talk about this. And Refik was interested in the question about memories, because in the movie, of course, in Blade Runner, the replicants don't have memories. They're given these photographs, a set of photographs of someone else's childhood, and they're told to claim them as their own, and they refer to them as though they are their own. So they don't have memories. But his question was really, could you give a building memory? And could you bring a building to life and let it dream? And so in this installation, there are three sections about memory, consciousness, and dreaming, these three phases whereby it's structured according to this logic, whereby he's taking all this data and then projecting onto this as though it were a kind of human in some senses. Now, this is metaphorical. Clearly, you know, AI doesn't have memories, doesn't have dreams, doesn't have consciousness and all these things. But nonetheless, it's kind of a gesture that he's trying to do to try and bring the building alive, to basically restore LA to being the kind of city of science fiction, the city of Blade Runner that he had dreamed of. And actually, when this thing happened, there were various comments that had been made by those who were there who kind of say, well, at last, Blade Runner has come back to LA. We can almost feel, we can almost touch the science fiction of this particular moment. And so here we have this thing. And maybe I should just play you just a few brief moments so you can enjoy this. The music was also composed using AI. So the whole thing was a complete AI production that effectively launched Refik's career. It wasn't the first he'd done, but it was really, I think, the one that was most prominent and the one that really catapulted into the public consciousness. So let me just play you a brief section of the music that goes with this astonishing moment. Okay, so I want to, with that sort of introduction into the kind of theme of Blade Runner, I want to talk about three particular issues today. First of all, what I'm going to call machine hallucinations. Secondly, I want to look at which is basically how we can hallucinate images using AI. Secondly, I want to talk about neuroscience and how humans have a form of see the world through a form of controlled hallucination, at least according to the neuroscientist Anil Seth. And finally, I wanted to open up the question about whether we hallucinate architecture itself, which is a more speculative section that is unproven, but nonetheless trying to be suggestive about how we can take some of these ideas further. So first of all, machine hallucinations, and just I'll simply sort of say that this is the year, or this last year, first of all, and now it's really hitting home, when architecture woke up to the possibility of AI, partly because of a series of books that were published in the first half of 2022, two of which were my own. On the left-hand side, Architecture in the Age of Artificial Intelligence, which is more a kind of a text-based book, an introduction to AI for architects. On the right-hand side, an AD that was guest edited with Matthias Del Campo, which is more about images and very little text. In the scheme of things, possibly the book on the left is much more useful because the images are all out of date now because of developments that happen in terms of diffusion models, Midjourney and DALL-E and so on. What I want to do, though, is to show you broadly the kind of trajectory, the way in which the synthesis, the hallucination of images took off. And I want to go cover the sort of the shift in particular between, on the left-hand side, the first ever image that was produced that generated by deep learning of an architectural design, on the right-hand side, one that I did, but frankly, anyone else could do using Midjourney. So my starting point would be a kind of degree of skepticism that probably goes back to the very beginnings of computation itself, the Ada Lovelace would claim that a computer can't do anything it hasn't been programmed to do. And also Makoto Watanabe, who's a Japanese computer architect, a very established one, makes this comment back in 2017. Machines are better than people at solving complex problems with many intertwined conditions. In that realm, people are no match for machines, but people are the only ones who can create an image that does not yet exist. Machines do not have dreams. Well, he does go on to right after that to say, well, is that always going to be the case? And he says, probably not. And in fact, obviously, it's not the case. But it's interesting that he makes this comment, machines do not have dreams. Well, in fact, it wasn't long before, I would say that the deep learning revolution that allowed us to synthesize things started happening in 2006. And that was roughly the 50th anniversary of the coining of the term AI. And in the first 50 years, it has to be said that little had been achieved, but coincidentally, 2006 was roughly the time in which the deep learning revolution took hold. And this is largely because neural networks, which had been around at the very beginning, but hadn't been able to, were not very efficient because of the limitations of the technology at the time, suddenly came into their own. This is largely because of much better algorithms, hugely much greater computing power, the use of the cloud, so you could access the GPUs remotely, and so on, the generation of data, the investment, the interest, and so on. All of this led to this deep learning revolution, where suddenly AI took off because of neural networks, because of deep learning. Now, this is something that might look very straightforward to us now, but with the time was quite revolutionary. This is 2012, where in the internet ImageNet competition, Jeffrey Hinton and his team from Canada won the competition by using neural nets and showing that you could use them and much more reliably, much quicker, recognize the image of the bird on the left-hand side. So what we have here is a neural network that's made up of neurons and synapses, and the information basically that flows from the left to right. The pixels then are kind of processed through these hidden layers. It often can be 5,000 even, a huge number of hidden layers, until eventually it kind of comes up with an answer, a bird. Now, it's never 100% certain it's a bird. It's normally 99% basically, but it detects it. It's a bird. But then the real challenge, though, was not to recognize a bird, but how do you generate an image of a bird? And that was the holy grail for computer scientists. And then as a result of this, not long afterwards, a scientist, a Google engineer, Alex Morvinsev, was playing around with this and recognized that you could invert the flow. In other words, this neural network, if it operated in the opposite direction, in other words, going from sort of left to right, but going from right to left, you could generate an image of a bird, which is interesting in itself because it suggests that maybe the mechanism of interpretation, of recognizing things, of theory in general terms, is the opposite of the mechanism of generation, of creativity, of design. And it maybe explains why most theorists are not designers and most designers are not theorists. Anyway, what came out of this was what became known as deep dream. This somewhat trippy image here being an example of the kind of hallucinatory nature of the images produced. And what is significant here is the fact that it's clearly a network that's been trained on serpents or snakes or something, and these look like dogs, and this looks like an oil lamp or something. But the real problem is it's all over the place. It's, as it's called, pose invariant, and that's because some of the information about where things are positioned have been lost in the process as you invert the mechanism. So while it was trippy and it provided some kind of extraordinary, interesting kind of artwork and actually led to the first ever exhibition of AI generated art in 2018, it had its limitations. But then this guy, Ian Goodfellow, came along and he developed an alternative system called generative adversarial networks, or GANs, as they're called. And this is how a GAN operates. It's based on not one, but two neural networks. And there's one that's called a generator that generates images using random noise and produces something, but the discriminator is judging against a data set and deciding whether or not it's convinced by this image or not. And it either rejects it or accepts it. It's a bit like, let's say, somebody producing a fake Van Gogh and then a critic judging whether or not it is actually a Van Gogh. Now, what's interesting about this is it points towards another aspect of design. In other words, for a designer, you need to be critical. You've got to have a critical side to improve your design. And what's happening here is actually basically the discriminator is training the generator to produce better images. But at the same time, the discriminator, and think of the discriminator as a kind of critic or a theorist, needs to learn from the generator, needs to be inventive about how theory has got to be creative, just as design itself has got to be critical. So it kind of presents itself as a model of how we actually operate as architects. And it wasn't long before this system, and there are many forms of GANs, there's a whole zoo of different GANs, was able to produce this kind of thing. This is style GANs, and it's been used to hallucinate faces. And importantly, these are faces of people who do not exist. In other words, Makoto Watanabe's kind of comment that the AI couldn't dream, it couldn't produce something that does not exist, is clearly wrong, or at least it's been proven wrong now. And there is actually a site you can go to called This Person Does Not Exist, where every time you refresh your browser, another image of a person is produced. Now, the way that a GAN operates is basically you upload this material, and clearly there are thousands of images of what appear to be Hollywood's movie stars on the internet, and you can therefore train it on the basis of that and produce these astonishingly realistic images. There's also a site called This Cat Does Not Exist, and I'm sure there are many, many more. And it wasn't long before architects started to do something very similar. This is the work of Wanyu He of X-Cool. Wanyu used to work for Rem Koolhaas for 7 or 8 years, heads X-Cool equals X-Koolhaas. And she is probably the world leader in terms of developing deep learning AI software for architecture. And what you can see here is a neural network that's been trained on modernist buildings, and it's hallucinating fake buildings. These buildings do not exist. And in fact, there was a website that they produced, a very similar website called This Building Does Not Exist, which is no longer up, but it certainly was for a while. But the important thing also is to recognize that this is simply a two-dimensional image. It might look three-dimensional, but actually it's a two-dimensional image. And that points towards one of the limitations of GANs themselves. But the actual first attempt to generate something occurred in 2019. And that might not be very long ago, but it was eons away in terms of AI and its reception in architecture. In 2019, I teamed up with Patrick Schumacher and Zaha Hadid Architects and Refik Anadol. And with the funding of Google, we proposed to curate the British pavilion at the Venice Biennale, which eventually took place in 2020. Now, that seemed to me like a dream team. But at that time, AI was simply not on the horizon of consciousness of architects. Nobody knew about it. Nobody thought anything about it. And we weren't even shortlisted. We were not even shortlisted. It's impossible to imagine that now, but it's the case. Anyway, Refik went ahead and did what we were supposed to do, which is to say, we were proposing to hallucinate buildings. So he fed all the data of the work from Zaha's office into a neural network. And then even though Zaha's no longer with us, was able to interpolate, or in other words, to generate a design that could have been designed by Zaha herself. And there it is. This, in fact, was the image that we chose to put on the front cover of my book, Architecture in the Age of Artificial Intelligence. And it wasn't long before others are developing other techniques. This is cycle GANs, which goes beyond style GANs. So style GANs is simply interpolating. It's based on simply a limited data set, and therefore it's simply only able to average things out. But cycle GANs is when you start breeding one set of data off against another, and therefore you extrapolate, you're breeding and opening up to other possibilities. So this is the work of Karl Pimmelblau. It's a project called Deep Pimmelblau that Daniel Bolojam was the mastermind behind. And in 2021, this was the state of the art. This was absolutely the state of the art. It was based on the material from the office and data set of previous designs. And it was extrapolating and producing these other designs. It won the Digital Futures Award. It won an award from Acadia and so on. It was the very much the best that there was out there. And looking at some of these images, frankly, they're not bad. They're a bit glitchy, and every single GAN image is glitchy unless people have touched it up with Photoshop. But at the same time, there are recognizable structures or buildings that are beginning to emerge. So this was the image that the project we used for the front cover of the AD, Machine Hallucinations, which of course relates very much the title to what I'm going to talk about today. But then all that changed in the first half of last year when DALL-E 2 wasn't released, but was available in beta form to a number of specialists. And this is an example of really why suddenly people start paying attention to these diffusion platforms as they are known. These are very different to GANs. They operate through a different mechanism. They're based on Gaussian noise generated through a Markov chain that disrupts images, and in repairing the image, a new image comes out. So very different technique, and they're based on a vast pre-trained model, GPT-3, a pre-trained language model that's based on huge amounts of data. And what it does basically, although it's based on language, it can connect images with language through captions. So it's downloaded all this information from the internet, and it can generate images based on words, on prompts. And at the top here, we have a prompt, an astronaut on a horse. And that's become the whole logic of using diffusion platforms. We become prompt engineers. We write these prompts, but then they prompt us by coming up with these amazing suggestions. So what we have here then is an astronaut on a horse. Now, that never happened, right? But what it does is it searches and synthesizes from the material it has, and it extrapolates what would have happened if you had got an astronaut on a horse. And frankly, it is pretty astonishing. And there are other examples too. I mean, it's not very good at text, as you can see at the top here, but this one here of a cat dressed as French Emperor Napoleon holding a piece of cheese is pretty convincing, as indeed is this one. Oil painting of a teenager texting a boyfriend, beautiful lighting, Caravaggio, 1580. They didn't have mobile phones in 1580, they didn't have cell phones, but this is what maybe it would have looked like had they had it. But then, and it unbeknown to me, Refik Anadol was collaborating with Patrick Schumacher. And when I gave a lecture at the AA in May of 2022, I was speculating about when architects would really wake up the possibilities of AI. And Patrick said, but now we've suddenly realized what it can do. And what we have here is a Refik who had access to DALL-E before other people because he was a specialist in the area, was collaborating with Zaha's and producing the next generation of images, which as you can see is far superior to the first image that was produced. And when you look at these images, they're kind of the apparent three-dimensionality of these images, the quality of the detail and so on, way, way beyond what we could do with GANs. And what's more, not only could they do that, but as soon as it's released to the public, as happened with Midjourney and DALL-E in the second half of 2022, we could all do this. And this is me, you know, writing a prompt about a hotel room in the style of Zaha Hadid. And when you look at it, it's pretty convincing. You get this reflection here of the the bed again, the marble, you get this lighting at the top here, and these two pictures that weren't in the prompt but appear anyway on the wall. And you suddenly realize that this is not bad. And of course, since then, it's got much better. But you can see all of a sudden that it becomes accessible, and anyone can effectively start designing a building in the style of Zaha Hadid. And indeed, there are a whole series of these things that I generated based on this that point towards things that are really quite astonishing. I would never have imagined this myself. This came out of Midjourney. I would never imagine myself, and it's more than I would imagine. What's more, the good thing about these particular projects, this looks like Zaha, right? It looks like Zaha. The good thing about these images is that they are much quicker. They're based on this pre-trained model, and therefore you haven't got to train it yourself. They generate it in about 3 seconds. It's very, very quick. What's more, you don't have to have any technical knowledge. You haven't got to do any rendering and so on. All of a sudden, we can get this much better series of images that meant the whole series of books that had come out were obsolete because the images were no longer quite the quality of what we could produce here. So here we can see it doesn't have to be organic. It can be a rectilinear form. This is a modernist villa in the Swiss Alps. And look at this reflection here. And look at these Swiss Alps in the background. All I did was put in the prompt Swiss Alps, and it produced this amazing perspective on things. And so it goes on. What I've myself been doing in terms of using this Midjourney, I like to extrapolate. In other words, I like to breed two different data sets off against each other. So in this particular one, and I see that a bit like the grit in an oyster that produces the pearl in the end. So this kind of disturbance is one I produced. In this particular one, I'm producing furniture, but I'm using sharks in the prompt, and maybe you can see something of the texture of shark skin. I don't know, in the surface of these curious chair-like things. But what is clear is they are astonishing. There's things that I would never have imagined, and gradually over time, we got better models coming out. Better models that Midjourney was constantly updating and improving its model until we get this one, which is a hybrid version of an orchid and a stool in the style of Zaha. And this really has a strong sense of materiality. You can really understand what it is and how it can be. I then went to look at the possibility of producing fashion. And this is a pufferjack, and I use zebras in the prompt to try and introduce some zebra-ness or something, some characteristics in the jacket. And it looks pretty convincing. In the background, we've got the zebras, but these images, these puffer jackets are astonishing. I mean, that you could imagine making these things. And you know, this was done so easily. And I'm not trained as a fashion designer. And sometimes, of course, you get not just people wearing zebras, but also zebras wearing puffer jackets as well. But this is astonishing, because if I can do this, it kind of suggests, well, that a fashion designer can also generate architecture, or indeed anyone can generate architecture, which itself becomes somewhat terrifying. But again, I mean, look at the quality of whatever these kind of hoodies are. I mean, really, really astonishing. I'm just blown away by this. In fact, I don't know anybody who's been using Midjourney and DALL-E who hasn't been blown away by the possibilities that it affords. So, and these were, for some reason, there was kind of strange here, which kind of points towards the contextual nature of where it is searching. Most of these models, even if I put in European models, it will still produce someone who looks African. And that's precisely because zebras themselves come from Africa, and it was making that association. And I did one on cow print jackets, and I guess they thought it was Denmark or something, because they get these very distinct European looking models coming out of this. And then Bjork Ingels himself, which is interesting, because if you want to try and locate an architect, you've got to find someone who's got a very unusual name like Bjork Ingels, but also who has a lot of presence on the internet. There are plenty of images of this person on the internet. So this worked out particularly well. But if you try a very common name like John Smith, it's never going to work. So then I started, and then as it started getting better and better, I started exploring other things. And this is an interpretation of Mies van der Rohe's Barcelona Pavilion, where you don't actually get the Barcelona Pavilion, but it treats the language of the Barcelona Pavilion as though it's a shape grammar, and you get many different kind of possible reconfigurations of what it could be, which again is pretty astonishing. And the level the quality of the rendering is almost like you don't need to do any rendering anymore. It's just a different, an absolutely different sort of level. And then my next thing was to try and think, well, what happens if we were to take Mies and combine him, let's say, with Louis Barragan? Barragan had an amazing sense of color. Mies was almost entirely monochrome. What would happen when you started introducing Barragan's color palette into Mies van der Rohe? And you get this astonishing series of images, very, very convincing, of a kind of Barragan-inspired Mies that is... it's kind of fictional, but at the same time, it kind of points towards how we can draw upon this to inspire us and to come up with alternatives to what we already know. I then moved on to dealing with a particular kind of rather unusual poisonous frog from the Amazon, and I used it. And you can see the patterns that it's generating, because this frog has very strange patterns on its back. And it started producing these astonishing designs. In fact, most of them, actually 90%, had a frog in it. But I removed the ones with frog in it, and these are the ones that just simply are kind of frogifying, shall we say, that are producing this side, which are producing these very, very novel architectural forms. Truly, truly astonishing. So all of a sudden, we have this technique that is out there that expands the possibility of what we could ourselves imagine. We like to think that we're imaginative as architects, but frankly, I don't think we are. And I think what these are doing are effectively enhancing what we could do as architects themselves. So how do we imagine this from a kind of theoretical perspective? I would suggest that even though they're not GANs, the model of the GANs still holds true, because effectively, we become the discriminator. We become the discriminator, and human beings are good discriminators. If you if we can sip a cocktail, instantaneously say whether we like the cocktail. We can smell some perfume and straight away say whether we like the perfume. So we're very good at discriminators, but I would argue we're a bit limited as discriminators, as generators. We don't have that as much imagination as we like to think we have. So what happens is basically, the AI or Midjourney and DALL-E, whatever, is opening up the possibility beyond what we could imagine, and giving us more, generating more options. So we, as the discriminator, can then choose which options that we have. So in other words, we can see this as a kind of enhancement, as a prosthesis that is making us much more proficient. And what I would simply say is that we have to recognize that what is often said is, that is to say, that we need to find out about these things, because someone who uses AI is clearly better than someone who doesn't use AI. And what they say about the future is, those who don't use AI will be replaced by those who do. And of course, the danger is, down the line, is that one person using AI can achieve more than four or five people who are not using AI, which tends to suggest that maybe some architects will become redundant. And this is one of the themes, I think, is AI is amazing, but also terrifyingly amazing. So I want to move on now to the question of neuroscience, and to think about how we can also see the way that we as human beings think and perceive the world as a form of hallucination. Not quite the same as hallucinating images, but the term hallucination nonetheless comes into it. So, for example, we can see that Refik, in his work, often uses the term machine hallucinations. This is an installation that he had in New York called Machine Hallucinations, where he actually was using thousands of images of buildings from New York. And out of those things, he was basically, he was producing this hallucinatory animated video. So the term hallucination is not the same, right? It's very different. But can we see certain similarities between the hallucinations of AI, the machine hallucinations of AI, and the hallucinations of the mind itself? So I want to introduce you to the work of Anil Seth. Anil Seth is a neuroscientist, a leader in his field. He's a specialist in consciousness, but he did a PhD in AI. And there's an interesting overlap between the world of neuroscience and the world of AI. And neuroscience, frankly, is the new theoretical paradigm we need to engage with. And in Digital Futures, we had a whole series on AI, neuroscience, and architecture that was absolutely fascinating. But what we also get in alongside, you know, people working on AI moving into neuroscience, we get people who are interested, who first of all do neuroscience and then go into AI. Demis Hassabis of DeepMind is like that. Jeffrey Hinton was like that. So in a sense, we get a convergence between these two different disciplines, as though really what they're both looking for is intelligence itself. They're trying to understand what intelligence is. And this book, Being You, is a bestseller, and it really summarizes the arguments of Anil Seth very clearly. But I would also refer you to the TED Talk, one of the most amazing TED Talks I've ever watched, where Seth kind of draws out offers his theory of how our perception of reality is a form of controlled hallucination. Now, what does he mean by that? Well, Seth's view is basically that the brain is locked into a bony skull. It has really little perception of what's going on in the world outside, except through some very imprecise electrical signals that it's receiving. And what it's trying to do is trying to interpret those signals. And it's trying to interpret the signals based on what it already knows. It engages in a form of what is called predictive perception, which is really the new paradigm in the world of neuroscience. And it's trying to predict what is out there or guess what is out there based on what it knows already. So in the TED Talk, I'll just produce a few kind of slides from the TED Talk, is that you begin to sort of challenge this notion that we see the world as it is, but rather he's arguing we see the world as we have been trained to see the world. All this puts the brain basis of perception in a bit of a different light. Instead of perception depending largely on signals coming into the brain, which is our standard view, we're just recording things, right? Instead of perception depending largely on signals coming into the brain from the outside world, it depends as much, if not more, on perceptual predictions flowing in the opposite direction. That is fascinating. We are predicting things. We are guessing what is out there. And we are part of the process of trying to understand what that world is. We don't just passively perceive the world. We actively generate it. The world we experience comes as much, if not more, from the inside out as from the outside in. And this leads him to his astonishing conclusion. If hallucination is a kind of uncontrolled perception, then perception right here and right now is also a kind of hallucination, but a controlled hallucination. We are hallucinating our reality. That is an astonishing, mind-blowing insight that's coming out of neuroscience right now. And I just want to simply kind of to put this alongside other insights that are previous insights. This is a work of Slavoj Žižek, the psychoanalytic thinker, the Lacanian psychoanalytic thinker, a thinker who draws upon Lacan. And according to Lacanian view, we never see the world, we never engage with reality anyway. It comes to us through the lens of the imagination, through the detour of the imagination, through the lens of fantasy. In other words, rather than seeing fantasy and reality as being two opposite and exclusive categories, in fact, according to Lacanian perspective, we see reality through the lens of fantasy. Fantasy is constitutive of how we see reality. Far from being a kind of fragment of our dream that prevents us from seeing reality as it effectively is, fantasy is constitutive of what we call reality. The most common bodily reality is constituted via a detour through the maze of imagination. The ultimate lesson of virtual reality is the virtualization of the very true reality. In fact, the lesson, I think he's trying to suggest it, it comes out of the title, from virtual reality, the virtualization of reality, is that what virtual reality teaches us is not how virtual reality is, but rather how virtual reality itself is. Let me repeat that. What virtual reality teaches us is not how virtual reality is, but rather how virtual reality itself is. And this is very similar to the conclusion that David Chalmers comes up with his kind of philosophical treatise on virtual reality that he published fairly recently. So there seems to be a kind of consensus of opinion. We don't see reality as it is, but rather we see reality as we've been trained to see reality. So what does this mean in terms of architecture? What can AI tell us about the mind of the architect? Do we hallucinate buildings? Let me just take you back to give a very graphic example of Anil Seth's concept notion that we see the world in the way that we are trained to see the world, not the world as it is. Now, if you were to ask any kid, any school kid anywhere in the world, and ask them how many colors there are in a rainbow, the chances are that they would all say 7. Please, sir, I know the answer, right? And they would say red, orange, yellow, green, blue, indigo, violet. And they'd be very happy with themselves because they thought was the right answer. But is that the case? In fact, if we look at an actual rainbow, it's fairly clear that there's infinite spectrum, or a spectrum of infinite colors in a rainbow. There aren't just 7 colors. We're trained to recognize 7, but actually there's an infinite number of colors in a rainbow. It's not that, it's that. So we have to sort of ask ourselves whether this standard perception that has been inculcated in every single school kid, there have been 7 colors in a rainbow, is correct. And clearly it's not. We could apply the same principle to architecture. Ask a student of architecture what is a functionalist building, and they will probably come up with something like this: Le Corbusier's Villa Savoye en pilotis and with a flat roof. Now, are flat roofs functional? Well, in the country from which I come, from the UK, they're certainly not functional because it rains a lot in the UK and flat roofs leak. So there's nothing functional about a flat roof, and yet we have been trained to think that this is a functionalist building. I want to play you here the work of Memo Acton, who is one of the most astonishing, he's a polymath, he's a computer scientist, he's an AI artist and so on, who basically articulates from a kind of artwork, shall we say, what Anil Seth is arguing. In other words, we don't see the world as it is, but as we have been trained to see the world. And what we're getting here, on the left-hand side, you can see Memo with a bit of cloth, and later on with some keys and some cables and things. And on the right-hand side, what a neural network will do, how it will interpret these on the image on the left through the lens of what it's been trained on. So this neural network has been trained on the ocean, and the cloth has been interpreted as the ocean. But there are other, as we play this, there are other parts of this where we suddenly find ourselves going from the ocean to for example, having flowers or having fire. Here we have fire here, and you can see his hand becoming, as it were, fire. This is the logic of that Anil Seth is talking about. Here we have the flowers. On the left here, keys, cables, chargers, and so on, interpreted through the lens of a neural network trained on flowers to see things in this particular way. This is how our mind works. And is it the way that architects are also being trained to think? Are we trained to see the world in a certain way, just as a neural network is trained to see the world? So let me show you a piece of work by one of my students at FIU, Florida International University, Fernando Salcedo, who did a very similar operation, but connected it to architecture. And so on the left-hand side, we're going to see aspects of Fernando's wardrobe, his t-shirts, his ties and things. And there are two different neural networks here. This is one based on the work of Zahar. It's trained on a particular science research center in Saudi Arabia. And what it basically does, it sees the world of Fernando's wardrobe, of his t-shirts, and starts architecturalizing it. It starts translating this into architecture. Now, the question I want to ask, is this how we as architects operate? Do we take inspiration from the world out there and interpret it through the lens of our architectural imagination, and do we architecturalize it? And then there's this one where he takes his wardrobe, takes his tie, and with a neural network trained on the very standard generic buildings, tower blocks in downtown Miami, here we see it here, there's his tie, and that tie becomes a tower block. This is fascinating. Does this give us some inkling of how the mind of the architect operates? Well, we can't prove anything. All we can do is speculate about this possibility. But to my mind, this is a fascinating demonstration, an illustration perhaps, that we, when we see things out there, when we're inspired by things in nature, we, as it were, turn it into architecture. So one example, I guess, of this term architecturalization, it's an ugly term, but I think it's an interesting term, would be the Sydney Opera House. Jørn Utzon was inspired by the billowing sails of the yachts in the harbour, and that's what led to this incredible sketch of the Sydney Opera House. In other words, he took the sails of yachts in the harbour and architecturalized them. They become the vaults of the Sydney Opera House. And how many times do we see this? Architects being inspired by things out there. But it doesn't simply apply to forms. Importantly, it also applies to concepts within architectural theory. Let's take, for example, the concept of the fold in Deleuze, in this book here, the famous book, The Fold, Leibniz and the Baroque. Well, actually, those of you who know Deleuze will know that he's not talking about the fold as such. He's talking about subjectivities, human subjectivities, nothing at all physical or anything. But architects see the world fold and they think, oh, I could do that in Maya programming. I could produce this kind of fold. And what do we get? We get on the left-hand side the AD, folding in architecture, which kind of takes that concept of the fold and architecturalize it and say, well, you can generate architecture based on this. And as a result of that, also, you can find other examples from the Bartlett, for example, the concept of the discrete. Jill Retzen produced an AD on the discrete based on the principle that the digital is discrete. Well, we know that, but it doesn't mean, say, discrete forms. And what he does, though, he said, okay, we take the concept of the discrete and we produce discrete pieces of architecture, discrete components that feed into architecture. I mean, it looks very nice, but it's got nothing to do with the logic of the discrete. And it's not, certainly there's no real logic about it, except from borrowing these concepts from other worlds. Another one, with example of Mario Capo, who reads that big data is messy. Big data is messy. And then he thinks, well, what is the style of big data? And he produces this design for a chair that actually is designed by Gilles and Manu, and says, that is the style of big data. Well, is it? I mean, frankly, big data has nothing to do with form. It's about information. And just take the example of Uber car. An Uber car, what is the style of an Uber car? Does it look any different from an ordinary car? No, because it is an ordinary car. All it's doing is harnessing information in a different way through the logic of the Uber app. And that's what allows us to operate particularly effectively. So it's not about form, it's about information, but architects are obsessed with form and they tend to sort of read that the whole time. Another example would be the term deconstruction that Derrida uses. Is he talking about architecture? No, he's not. He's talking about how we are constructed as individuals. An example would be that example of the rainbow. We are constructed, socially constructed, trained to see the rainbow as consisting of seven colors, but it's not. But that is the way that we've been constructed. And for Derrida, it's really a question of challenging all those perceptions, all those hierarchies that are written into Western metaphysics, and questioning them and challenging the way in which we've been, in some sense, biased through the logic of this training, and to try and eradicate that bias. But architects see the word construction and suddenly start thinking it means to refer to architecture. Derrida was once asked, I was there at a lecture that he gave, what did he make of all these architects who are using this term to produce these buildings? And he kind of, first of all, he said nothing for a while. He said, maybe it's better not to respond than to respond irresponsibly. And then he said, well, I don't know. There have been these books, there's been the exhibitions, there've been these conferences and so on, but I've got no clue what deconstruction in architecture has got to do with the concept of deconstruction in philosophy. There is, however, I think, the possibility that maybe the world of AI, the world of computation, can itself open up the possibilities of what it means to be human. And I want to just kind of show you the example of something that was developed in the 90s by Craig Reynolds, who wanted to try and map or model the behavior of birds, the flocking behavior of birds. And what he did was develop these things called buoys. And in order to understand the flocking behavior of birds, you had to understand the rules behind the flocking behavior of birds, which he did through a process of reverse engineering. And all of a sudden, everyone, including the bird ornithologists and bird experts, at last began to realize what was the logic of flocking behavior of birds. And there's a whole discourse about that called swarm intelligence, about how they actually behave and so on. But it was a breakthrough. In other words, computation began to tell us how nature itself operates. And my interest is whether AI can tell us how the human mind works. Let's return to the very starting point, to Blade Runner. Let's return to Rutger Hauer, who tragically never lived to see the date in which the film movie Blade Runner was set. But he made the comment nonetheless that really what Blade Runner was all about was not about replicants. It was about what does it mean to be human? What does it mean to me? In many ways, Blade Runner wasn't about the replicants. It was about what it might mean to be human. And similarly, the Japanese roboticist Hiroshi Oshigoro, who has this curious habit of producing replica versions of himself, and I wouldn't say which is him and which is his replica, he makes this comment, the robot is a kind of mirror that reflects humanity, and by creating intelligent robots, we can open up new opportunities to contemplate what it means to be human. And I would say they're both similarities, but also differences. The mirror can also reveal differences. So my question I want to ask is whether AI can become a mirror in which to understand the mind of the architect. And let me finish off with this astonishing example of the work of Marcus Kay. Marcus Kay is an AI artist who is disabled. Now, for this presentation, he wrote a text. Now, he has a condition that was very similar to the late Stephen Hawking, who had motor neuron disease. He also has a neuronal disorder, and he's confined to a wheelchair, can scarcely get out of bed, and he certainly can't speak. So what we did was to take a text that he had generated, and we then used AI to give him a voice. It's not his voice, but it's a voice. And we used technology to be able to transport his work, even though he couldn't get out of his bedroom, to transport his work as though on a magic carpet to all parts of the world. So anyway, this I want to play you this, this video, Marcus Kay talking about his motivation. And I want you to pay attention particularly to the moment where he says that AI gives us a sense of what it is to be human.
Hello, my name is Marcos K. I am a disabled artist and director with a focus on art and science. Over the past two decades, I have been working exclusively with generative art methods. Generative art is any kind of art created with an autonomous system. It is a practice which has a long history starting from ancient times. In modern times, it is usually associated with art generated by computer algorithms or code with early experiments starting from the 1960s. The way computational generative art works is by setting initial parameters and then letting the computer generate an image based on those parameters. Even though there is control over these initial parameters, there is no control over exactly what the computer will generate, and thus the art can be thought of as autonomously made. In my own practice, I have always set out to give the computer as much control as possible. I take the role of a director, guiding the computer to express my concepts and ideas, but also letting it express itself through its algorithms. One way of thinking about this is like the filming of a documentary, where there is control over some aspects like the time and location, the positioning of cameras and recording equipment, but the events are allowed to play out on their own with no intervention. AI-generated art is the evolution of this same process and the next step in the long history of generative art. With generative AI tools, again we set some initial parameters that set algorithms in motion, which then generate an image based on training data. There is an element of randomness added to this, known as a Monte Carlo algorithm, which is the same method 3D software and scientific simulations use. The output is a recording of this interplay of algorithms that was triggered by our initial input. The impact of this technology will be huge. It will change the way we approach many disciplines, and it is already becoming a new paradigm in the way we approach knowledge and science. I see AI permeating every aspect of digital creation and changing the way we interact with computers in general. This is only the beginning, and everyone experimenting with this new medium is bringing something different into the mix. In a few years, AI tools and all these techniques we are developing right now will become standard practice in the industry. Some people believe that the output of AI is not original but merely derivative. However, these outputs are directed by us and our unique combination of references, viewpoints, and experiences, which bring a unique human element to the equation. The human aspect cannot be separated from AI. It is trained on human data and it is created by humans. It is both a tool and an art form. Art is about intention and expression, and thus it is about human communication. It is up to us to use this tool to communicate in imaginative and original ways. AI technology is giving artists the chance to find new creative pathways and to express themselves in ways that weren't possible before because there was not enough time or means. I have been able to visualize projects that I thought would never see the light of day in a matter of days. As someone with a serious disability, this has been nothing short of a miracle, as it has given me the ability to create and express myself again, which I felt I had lost because of my illness. This technology is making art accessible to millions of people that couldn't express themselves before for whatever reason or limitation, which is very exciting to see. Working closely with AI can be a very reflective and introspective process. There are a lot of things it can reveal about ourselves and the nature of reality. As human organisms and brains, we could be compared to statistical models that have been trained with incoming data over thousands of years, just like these AI systems. There is something called the AI effect, whereby every time an AI achieves something, it is discounted as not real intelligence. People might be doing this subconsciously to retain their feeling of uniqueness, but as AI gets better at things we consider exclusively human, it becomes a reflection of the ways our biological systems are automated. This is fascinating because through creating simulations of brain processes such as these neural networks, we get to learn more about our own brains. This ties in with my work from over the last two decades, which has been an investigation on how simulations have become the main tools of observation of in science. Ultimately, this technology can be thought of as a reflection of the human condition and a mirror for us to understand ourselves better. It is an incredible tool that opens a world of possibilities and new discoveries. Right now we are just scratching the surface. This is only the beginning.